So, good morning, everyone. Again, many thanks for joining this open air webinar. This webinar is part of a series of webinars that Open Air Nexus is organizing. Our goal is to organize a set of webinars focusing all the open air services. Today, the service that this webinar will focus is the OpenAPC. And in the upcoming months, we are expecting to have more webinars targeting the other open air services. So, you are invited also to participate in these upcoming webinars. So today, our webinar it's about the Open APC service, and before start the presentation, just a few housekeeping rules. So this event will be recorded. By default, the participants' microphones are off, but at the end, we will have some time for questions and answers, and you are able to open the microphone and make your questions. If you want to participate, you can use the chat to introduce yourself, to interact with participants, and write some questions to the speakers. And you are also able to raise your hand to speak. The presentation and recording will be shared with you by email after this presentation. And you can also share this event in the social media using the OpenAir hashtag or referencing the Twitter channel of OpenAir and OpenAPC. So, making this brief introduction, today we'll have Dirk Pieper and Andreas Czerniak from Bielefeld University, Germany, that will present the Open APC service. So many thanks for accepting our invitation to make this presentation. And I pass the word to you. Many thanks.
So thank you, André. Thank you for the opportunity to give the presentation here about the new Open Air Nexus service, OpenAPC, today, and also welcome from our side. Let me share my screen. Okay. So I hope you see my screen. Yes. Moment in full screen. Perfect. Thank you. So in our presentation today, we give a brief overview about the cost transparency of open access publishing. And we will take a closer look to the European Open Science Cloud integration in open air. So today, I'm with Dirk Pieper, present the OpenAPC service. Dirk Pieper is a deputy head of the Bielefeld University Library and one of the co-initiator of the OpenAPC initiative. And we will make the presentation today. I'm extremely glad to see Christoph Boschinski and Jochen Schierpark also here with us. Thank you very much. So my name is Andreas Czerniak, and I'm the project officer at Bielefeld University for OpenAIR, and led the task to integrate the OpenAPC into the OpenAIR ecosystem. So now I would like to hand over to Dirk, and the virtual floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you, Andreas. Thank you, André, for your kind introduction. I will have the first two parts of the presentation. Andreas, can you click for me? Thank you. I will give a short introduction about OpenAPC and we'll talk about how to participate in this project. And then Andreas will take over and speak about the European Open Science Cloud and OpenAIR integration. And in the end, we will give you a short conclusion and outlook about OpenAPC. Okay, short introduction about APC. OpenAPC can be described as an open data project, which it is from the very beginning. We started in 2014, and we have in general two aims. One aim is to release data sets on fees paid for open access journal articles and monographs. And the second aim is to enable a transparent and reproducible reporting for institutions and funders. And by this, we want to create cost transparency on the APC and BPC market. This was, I think, very new in 2014. And we are still around. We received some funding from the German Research Foundation, from the Federal Ministry of Education and Research in Germany, and we are happy that we can take the next step and have a broader vision in the European context with OpenAPC. Okay. One part of OpenAPC is the acronym APC. What are article processing charges? I think most of you are familiar with this. At the beginning of the 2000s, some open access publishers came to the market, like PLOS, Biomed Central, Frontiers, and so on. And APCs are more or less a price tag for articles in those kind of journals. And they can be defined as a one-time fee to a publisher to have an article published in a fee-based open access journal. Of course, I know that there are a lot of open access journals that don't want to have APCs, but as I said at the beginning, some main publishers with recent parts of the publication output in universities or other institutions want to have APCs for open access journal articles, and they are widely used for publications. I don't know how it is in other countries, but as far as I know, normally APCs are paid either by academic institutions, by funders, or by authors themselves, or by libraries. And in Germany, we had a huge funding program by the German Research Foundation, which started already in 2010. And which supported academic libraries or academic institutions in Germany to create organizational structures in order to support the payments of APCs. And as far as I know, in other countries, these kind of programs happen as well. So when these programs or funding started, we figured out that we needed transparent reporting and some cost monitoring for publications and journals. And if you look at more recent funding projects, like for example, the Horizon Europe's General Model Grant Agreement, we are now in the phase where the European Commission says that only publication fees in full open access venues for peer-reviewed scientific publications are eligible for reimbursement. This is even more strict than the Coalition S or Plan S is delivering. They allow funding also for OA articles in hybrid journals as far as they are within a transformative agreement. And it's interesting to see that the European Commission took another step forward, maybe because the Horizon Europe program is running until 2027. But we see that APCs will be with us for the next years, I would say. Okay, next slide, please. And of course, APCs are not the only fees to be paid within open access publishing. There are also so-called book processing charges. From my experience in at our university, I would say that a lot of scientists, especially from the humanities and social sciences, said, it's great that you support journal article published in open access journals or in hybrid journals, but what about the disciplines which like to publish books? And that was one motivation also to think about how we can create a transparent reporting for book processing charges. And I will talk about this in a minute. Next slide, please. What we also see since, I would say, 2015 or so, when these kind of agreements were maybe called offsetting agreements, we see that with international initiatives like OA 2020 or other initiatives, see that transformative agreements become more and more important. And what they are trying to do is that they want to transform subscription-based journals into OA. And also very important, they want to transform the spendings for subscriptions into OA publishing. And it's very, let's say, complicated to calculate the costs per article within those kind of transformative agreements, because they still incorporate historical subscription expenditures. And on the other hand, they are, as I said in the beginning, very important because they have the potential to transform large numbers of articles in hybrid journals into OA. Maybe you've heard of the German Deal project. And I think since 2019 to 2020, we have two big transformative agreements with Wiley and Springer Nature. And in those 2 or 1.5 years, more than 23,000 articles in those hybrid journals were transformed into open access. Of course, we are in a transition, and therefore we need to know how much an article is or how much the article costs in those kind of transformative agreements. And that's why we in OpenAPC are also dealing with transformative agreements as well. And yeah, I mentioned it before, Plan S is still allows a reimbursement for articles in hybrid journals within transformative agreements, but the European Commission for Horizon Europe is now only reimbursing articles within Gold OA journals. Okay, next slide, please. This is a short overview how the number of records or the number of articles developed over the years. Next slide, please. There you can see how the number of articles grew during the last 3 years for transformative agreements. And next slide, please. Here's a short description how much articles we have currently in our data sets. We think, of course, the APC data set, which we originally started in 2014, is by far the biggest one. BPC was only started last year, and in this case, I think we are in the beginning. And transformative agreements, since 2016, we see also a lot of articles. But only a small part of it has cost data as well, and I will talk about this in a minute. Okay, this is only a short overview for the data sets we are currently offering. Okay, next slide, please. And this is maybe even more important, deals with the question how to participate in OpenAPC. And of course, we want to convince those people who are not part of OpenAPC to be part of OpenAPC and to be part of the community. When you will get the slides, you can click on the links in this slide. All I want to say in the presentation is that we have a kind of handout which describes in detail how to participate and how are the requirements for the data we want to have. We've learned in a lot of talks and a lot of discussions how to define the costs of OpenX publishing, how to deal with discounts, for example, or how to deal with taxes. And all this is described in detail on this website. Then we have, in general, two ways how to deliver data. One way is to deliver a CSV file, just simple with an email. This is preferred by most of the data providers. For those people who are maybe a little bit more technical advanced, they can create GitHub pull requests and deliver the data with this mechanism into OpenAPC. And but what we want to achieve during the next year in a new project, which is funded by the German Research Foundation, is that we want to harvest those kind of data via OAI PMH. And we think that this way has some advantages. Also for the delivering institutions for OpenAPC, but it also has the potential to strengthen the role of institutional repositories in this environment, because of course every institution who is funding open access articles or is paying for open access articles also wants to disseminate those articles within their institutional repository. We made a proposal, I think some years ago, how to define a metadata set, which also incorporates cost information for articles. And we have implemented it with some pilots in Germany. And our goal for the next year is that we want to have more data providers within OpenAPC using this mechanism in order to deliver data to OpenAPC. And if you want to get more information about this, you can click on the link and see our proposal for the metadata format and the way how to integrate cost information in your metadata set in your institutional repository. Okay, next slide, please. Over the years, we see that, of course, single institutions like universities are providing data, but we also have a lot of national aggregators like for example, the Austrian Science Fund or JISC in UK. We have also a national library consortia, like, for example, the Couperin Consortium in France. We have a Swiss consortium, which is very active in providing data to OpenAPC. We have national, international funders are providing data to OpenAPC, like, for example, the Wellcome Trust or the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And we are happy to get as much as data as we can. And no matter if it is a single institution or aggregator, if there are aggregators in certain countries, then of course it would be great that there is a kind of, let's say, agreement or communication between an institution and an aggregator in this country. We also learned over the years that the expenditures for OA publications are often managed centrally in universities, for example, by the university libraries, but we've learned that it's often not the case. And it's for those institutions, it's normally very, very hard to get the information out of the university or the academic institution. And we have seen in many countries, France, for example, but also in Finland, that libraries, for example, are trying to, or library consortia are trying to get the data out of the institutional financial systems. This is very hard work, and we have a lot of respect for those institutions who are doing this. And of course, nobody can expect that every data set is complete 100%. Also, the libraries and universities normally don't achieve 100% of every expenditures for OA publication, but that's not the goal. The goal is to get, let's say, an insight or an overview about how many publications are funded or paid in an academic institutions, and to get a feeling which publishers are preferred, what are the prices which are paid, and nobody expects 100% completeness. And yeah, therefore we are happy no matter how you get the data, if you get the data out of the financial system or if you have, let's say, a monitoring in your library, no matter how it is, we are happy about every data set we can get for OpenAPC. Okay, next slide, please. This is a slide Christoph created some months ago, which shows what we are doing with the data you are delivering. I don't want to get too much into detail, but you can see that the DOI is a very relevant identifier for journal articles or for books, for example. Another very important identifier, if there is no DOI for books, is the ISBN number, and everything starts with the identifiers. And if you look at the left side of the graph, you can see that we are trying to enrich the bibliographic data out of certain sources like Crossref. We are enriching identifiers, for example, from Europe PubMed Central. We are looking for ESSN numbers, ESSNL number, for example. We are looking for a unique title number out of Web of Science. And what you are getting in return for providing us your data is that you get an enriched file with a standardized set of bibliographic data and identifiers. And in 2020, we tried to set up the same way for monographs, which was a challenge, of course, because monographs and articles are not the same thing, of course. We wanted to show that this kind of enrichment can also be done for books. There are certain problems or challenges regarding books, maybe not solved 100%, but in general, it is possible to get the same enrichment steps also for books as well. Okay, next slide. If you want to deliver data for Open Access Journal articles, here are some main information about this. As I said before, the data set contains 18 fields, and only 5 have to be delivered by an institutions which are marked. We need the name of the institution, we need the period in which the article was published. We need the information, how much do you have paid for the article, if you are using another currency, like, I don't know, British pound or whatever, you can deliver the original currency as well. We can calculate the euro price for you. Very important is the DOI of the article, and also important is the information if the article was published in a gold open access journal or in a hybrid journal. Okay, this is all we want to have from you, and everything else on the right side is then enriched and delivered by OpenAPC. In return, of course, you can use the data for your own reporting systems, but everything we are doing is documented on GitHub. The data are generally visualized in a so-called tree map. Maybe you can put on the next button or push the next button, Andreas. Right, every institution which is delivering data can also get a tree map for the data, and this kind of tree map also can be embedded in local websites, which is done by a lot of universities or institutions worldwide. And of course, we can do a kind of basic analysis on the whole data set. You can see here, for example, information about the average cost per publisher in euro, and you can compare it with other publishers as well. You can say, for example, I don't know, Public Library of Science is maybe even, I don't know, maybe cheaper than for example, Frontiers or whatever. So you can make your decisions, what kind of publishing do you want to promote at your own institution as well. Also, this kind of information helps you to plan your budget, of course, when it comes to financing Open Access publishing in your institution. Okay, next slide, please. We have the same for the BPC data. Also, there are five mandatory data fields, and everything else is enriched, which you can see here. And maybe we can go on to the next slide. There are, in the same way, there are created reports on GitHub, tree maps are generated out of the data as well. And then we can have some analysis about this, but again, we only started the BPC data set. Of course, there are some books in it, there are some records in it, but from our feeling, it's only the beginning and maybe not representative enough to give figures about the whole market of BPCs in this early stage. Okay, next slide, please. This is, of course, very relevant because we see a lot of transformative agreements worldwide. And we have the same requirements for the open for AP, like APC data for data out of transformative agreements. But due to the complex calculation of article costs, most data providers don't submit institutional cost data per article in hybrid journals. As I said at the beginning, there are historical subscription expenditures involved, and this makes it very, very complicated to calculate average costs per article in this environment. But with the deal agreement, we started to do this. It was a very, let's say, complex discussion. And we are happy that we can provide now data for the two deal agreements in Germany, which incorporate cost data. If you can click on the next slide, please. You can see here the tree map which we are providing normally for the APC data here for the deal contracts. And this is the view on the journals, which are mostly used within the deal contracts. And you can easily see that, for example, the Scientific Reports or Angewandte Chemie International Edition or other journals are on the top 10 for publications within the deal contracts. You can easily see how much they cost. And if you look, for example, on the institutional level in this tree map, you can see how much every institution is paying for every article according to the relation between subscription expenditures and article output in these journals or within this publisher. So this is very, very, let's say, valuable information, because this gives us the information how to proceed in the future with transformative agreements. And of course, also again, this is not complete for every institution which is taking part in the deal contract, but we have a lot of big institutions, and you can see the basic mechanisms and the basic challenges we are facing in order to proceed with transformative agreements in the future. And all I can do is to say that other library consortia should try to think about how they can provide cost data as well for their articles within transformative agreements. It is possible within OpenAPC to report this kind of information. Okay, I think this was my last slide, and I will hand over to Andreas for the integration of OpenAPC in OpenAIR and the European Open Science Cloud.
Thank you, Dirk. So next is to take a look onto the integration into from the OpenAPC dataset into OpenAIR and then into the European Open Science Cloud. Briefly, the European Open Science Cloud is aim to have a virtual environment, trustworthy and federated, and for an interdisciplinary collaboration, and of course in a fair manner. So that's a very short points that we have, and we would like to achieve with some steps. On the one, I will present it only two ones here. One is the cost estimation for open access publishing for research funders. That is one that we are doing also in OpenAIR. And the other one is an estimating for cost publishing for researchers. So you can estimate the cost for publishing your research results. First of all, we integrate the OpenAPC dataset into the OpenAIR research graph. And now OpenAPC is a part of the OpenAIR Research Graph and also a service of OpenAIR. And the APC data was enriched with the organization identifiers that we get from ROAR and GRID, if we have, and enrich the graph with this information and the relations between the entities in the graph. So the APC data set have the relation to the publication, and in the OpenAIR graph, there are more relations to these publications for authors, projects, funding streams and funders and so on. And we have also the information in the APC data set for the organization, if it's available, and can also relate to these organizations directly. So we can create a full view with the APC of these specific articles and so on. This was done in the past month, and these APC, the usage of the APC data in the OpenAIR graph was used by the Open Science Observatory in the future and will be used there. At the moment, there are some other metrics for open science, but the APC data will be available here also. And the other one is the APC data. If the OpenAIR research graph knows this, but also present in the Explore portal. And this is an added value service for OpenAIR and also an added value service for the European Open Science Cloud. The OpenAIR research graph as a core of OpenAIR and OpenAIR portals and dashboards is also, will be also a part of the EOSC knowledge graph core. And in this case, the APC data was also integrated in the EOSC core and could be used as well, yeah, there. It's part of work. There's more work to do on this part at the moment, and I think we can give novelties in the later OpenAIR Nexus webinar here. As a conclusion for this presentation was that the Open APC dataset is fully transparent and community driven since in the last years. So we are getting feedback from workshops and presentations. Like this webinar, and after our presentation, this is a perfect place to ask questions about OpenAPC, APC and BPCs, and also transformation agreements. And we have an analytics cube to make analysis, like you've seen in the tree map or for visualization. And all these information of OpenAPC are published at GitHub in the raw way and in the rich way. So you find in the GitHub repository both data paths here. Another is part is that OpenAPC provides price and cost transparency to libraries and consortia. And of course, we use these information for institutional reporting and funder reporting, as you've seen before. And very important is that if we have more organizations and institutions to contribute to OpenAPC, so more interesting values can we give to the community back. And it's very helpful to have more data sets and in the OpenAPC projects. And if you would like to become a part of our community, please contact the OpenAPC at the University of Bielefeld email address, as you've seen before. And this is my last slide here before we come to some question and answers. Reference you see here for the OpenAPC website and the GitHub project. Also the APIs that can used from your side. One is the analytics cube of OpenAPC. It is described at olap.openapc.net. And also you can use the integrated APC data in the OpenAR graph via the API openair.eu website. It's also described how can you make a request to these API and how can you search for DOIs, and you if there is APCs on this DOI in the graph, so you can request this information from the OpenAR graph also. In this case, I would like to thank you all for your joining today, and also my colleagues Jochen and Christoph that are also being here with us. And we would like to open the question and answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Many thanks, Dirk and Andreas, for your presentation. So we have time for questions and answers. Might not, we have one question in the chat, but feel free to add more, or if you want to put directly the question, you can raise your hand and ask to open your microphone, and you can put your question directly to the speakers. The question we have in the chat is from Gita, and the question is price disclosure not protected by a trade secret?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe I can answer this question. I would say it depends, of course, on the contracts you have with the publishers. But on the other hand, in every country, I would say there are freedom of information laws. And so there's a kind of trade-off or discussion you have. What is more important, freedom of information or the protection within an agreement? And there have been a lot of initiatives, I would say, in the UK, in Finland, and so on. And normally, you are allowed to provide cost information on the article level when it comes to open access publishing. There is another source for, let's say, price information in the directory of open access journals for some publishers or some journals. And what we are trying to do with OpenAPC is that we want to indicate or report the costs in reality. Costs are something else than prices. And during the last years, we haven't seen any institution or any publisher which is trying to tell us it is not allowed to give this kind of information. It's an open data project, and so far we have had no problems when it comes to deliver the information about costs for journal articles.
Okay, thank you.
I hope this answers the question.
We have another question from Aniko. How many people are working on processing the data that are submitted by the institutions?
One. This is Christoph Wojcinski, which is also here. And this can only be done because the workflows behind it are very much automated. Even everything else, the tree maps, the website on GitHub or the blog, we are using our Markdown for it. Everything is done automatically or semi-automatically, I would say.
Okay, thank you. We have another question from Gabriela. Do you know who uses your data and what for?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there were some recent examples which are also linked in the presentation. For example, the European Commission recently put out a report about open access in the Europe Horizon project funding phase, and they used OpenAPC data as well for it. OpenAPC data are widely used in, for example, bibliometric studies when it comes to measure things about open access and their costs. In the presentation, you will find a recent publication by a bibliometric group also located at Bielefeld University, which used OpenAPC data. For example, library consortia are using this kind of data. I know that the people who are negotiating the deal contracts in Germany are using these cost points or price points when it comes to talk about the prices for articles in Harvard journals or articles in open access journals. And I know that other library consortia in Europe are using this as well.
Okay, many thanks. I don't know if we have more questions from the participants. Please feel free to ask if you have some doubts or if you want to clarify something. We have here the people in charge of OpenAPC, and you can make your questions. We have a question from Felix. How regularly is new data added?
Yeah, it depends. Normally, I would say that data delivering institutions are providing data once a year. And this is maybe a good way or a good let's say, time interval to provide data. So normally, when it comes, let's say, for 2020, then in the myth of 2021, most institutions have delivered data for the period before 2021.
And I can also add here that our blog is recently updated And if OpenAPC project receives APC data or BPC data or transmission agreement data, so we publish this the block of OpenAPC. So
yeah, there is a question regarding the BPC data. As I said in the presentation, we think that there's only a start for BPC data. There are two big, let's say, data provider. One provider is the Austrian Science Fund. The other data provider is Knowledge Unleashed. Both institutions have, let's say, a long tradition in funding open access books. I know that, for example, in Switzerland, there is a long tradition for funding open access books as well. As far as I know, in Germany, the funding of book processing charges, let's say started maybe in 2020 or 2019. I don't know how the situation in other countries is. So this really a start in this case.
We have another question from Ike. Would it make sense to add data retroactively if an institution joins the project?
Sure. Yeah. Sure. So every data is welcome. Also data from the past. Yeah.
Okay. Another question from Gabriela. I didn't notice. Is it possible to select the data about APC, BPC only for a specific country?
Yeah, this can be done via the tree map visualization. There you can see on the right side, you can select countries.
Okay. Thank you. I don't know if we have more questions. I think we have answered all the questions in the chat. We also have some useful links in the chat if you want to save the chat conversation. You can also do it. We will also share with you the recording and the slides in order to you to revisit the presentation and to consult the information about the OpenAPC, and how to use the service, how to join.
If there aren't any questions anymore, thank you very much for having us, and thank you for giving us the opportunity to talk about OpenAPC today. And all I can say in the end, we are happy to get new data providers to make the source even more valuable for all. And if you think about contributing to OpenAPC, please don't hesitate to contact us, and we are happy to support you and help you. Thank you.
Okay, many thanks, Dirk and Andreas, for your valuable presentation, for accept our invitation. And I would like also to thank you, all the participants, for joining this webinar. We will send you, as I said, the presentation and recording, and please stay tuned in the upcoming open air webinars. Many thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, André.
Have a nice day.
Thank you.